here, the Corinthian believers were not really different from a lot of saints today. Another writer said there were some pretty sorry saints at Corinth, but saints nonetheless. Because sainthood is not determined by an external list of rules, by what we do or how we live. Thank God, that's grace. Sainthood's bestowed as an act of God's grace, sovereign grace, on every believer. It makes sense then that in verse 3, Paul follows right on the heels of their sainthood by saying, grace unto you, and what comes next? Peace. Why naturally? Why naturally? Now, the word grace, as we said, is the Greek charis, and it was really used many different ways in Greek culture. It means a loving kindness bestowed gratuitously, like we said, upon the one being given to by the one doing the giving. It also contains the thought of making the recipient feel joy and comfort. So this is why we're looking at grace, age, blessings, the blessings of the cross. Because understanding these blessings is the key ingredient to the joy the Holy Spirit produces in our lives as we're told all that God has made us to be. Where we are, who we are, what we are. But grace contains that thought of making us feel joy and feel comfort. In fact, we still use the word grace in the English. Not charis, but we use the word grace in that sense today, if you think about it. There are times when we say someone was what type of a host? Well, a gracious host. Or we might refer to a home. What a gracious home, we might say. They have a home that's inviting is the idea there behind that. One that gives us a feeling of being welcome. It gives us a sense of well-being. But grace is used in an even greater sense when it refers to God as the giver. Here's a definition often used. Grace is a favor done without expectation of return. Grace is the absolute freeness. And I like this definition. Grace is the absolute freeness of the loving kindness of God displayed to men, finding its only motive in the bounty and free-heartedness of the giver. Now, that's pretty good right there. One of our people said a few years back, grace is being good for nothing. Well, you've got to understand how that was meant. We've got a whole lot to be good for, don't we? But you see the point there. We've summed it up many times here by using the phrase, something given for nothing returned. When God bestows grace upon believers, he bestows unmerited favor, unearned, undeserved favor on us, even though we do not, could not, never will deserve it. Then notice the second word Paul uses here. He goes on to say, grace be unto you, and we just notice the word, and you said it, peace. Just as Paul begins every epistle with his own name, he also opens every epistle that begins with his name, and they all do, with a declaration of grace and peace. Doesn't separate them, puts them together, grace and peace. Now, grace be unto you was a common Greek greeting in Paul's day, but Paul follows that up by using the common Hebrew greeting, peace or shalom. So Paul uses a common Greek greeting and he joins it to a common Hebrew greeting as he greets the body of Christ, which is at Corinth. And I believe there are several significant reasons why Paul used these two different greetings. For one thing, the body of Christ is made up today of Jews and Gentiles. We know during Paul's time both believers from both programs were still living. So Paul used a common greeting to both, a greeting to which both groups could easily relate. Then there's another facet to consider. What's the opposite of grace and peace? What would be the opposite of grace and peace? Judgment and war. Grace and peace, judgment and war. Psalms 2:19 tells about God's wrath being poured out upon this world. It's speaking about a time of judgment yet to come before Christ returns to this earth to rule and reign. Thank God we'll be called up off of this earth before that takes place. A time of judgment and war, the opposite of grace and peace. The period of time we know as the tribulation. I want you to notice with me Joel 3:9. I don't have it on the overhead, but I thought about it this morning, so I just turned to it so I could read it to you. And I'll just read you a few verses here. But if you want to mark this down for your notes, or if you've got your Bible, you might want to turn to Joel chapter 3, verse 9. And I'll just read down through verse 16. So if you don't have your Bibles, just listen closely. The opposite of grace and peace, sitting in Joel chapter 3, verse 9. This is coming up. This is describing, this is prophecy, this is predicting a day yet future. Thank God we won't be here. We'll be taken off this planet. But listen to this. Proclaim ye this among the Gentiles. Prepare war. Does that sound like grace and peace? Prepare war. Wake up the mighty men. Let all the men of war draw near. Let them come up. Beat your plowshares into swords and your pruning hooks into spears. Let the weak say, I am strong. Assemble yourselves and come, all ye heathen. The word translated heathen there in the King James, come, all ye heathen, is the word Gentiles or nations, Gentiles. Come, all ye Gentiles, and gather yourselves together round about. Thither cause thy mighty ones to come down, O Lord. Let the Gentiles be awakened and come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat, for there will I sit to judge all the Gentiles round about. Put ye in the sickle, for the harvest is ripe. Come, get you down, for the press is full, the fats overflow, for their wickedness is great. Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision, for the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. The sun and the moon shall be darkened, and the stars shall withdraw their shining. The Lord also shall roar out of Zion and utter his voice from Jerusalem, and the heavens and the earth shall shake. This is describing the tribulation period, a period of that great tribulation. But the Lord will be the hope of his people and the strength of the children of Israel. So you can see a division here in chapter 3 of Joel between the Gentiles and Israel. And this doesn't sound like grace and peace. This sounds like judgment and war. But you see, just when it looked like that time was about to take place, that time was here. God in his mercy began a brand new program. He set Israel's program aside for a time, and he ushered in an unprophesied period of time we call the dispensation, an unprophesied message we call the dispensation of the grace of God. And he committed the dispensation of grace to the Apostle Paul. So certainly that was one reason Paul could declare grace and peace to all those who would believe his message.